Hi, look, I'm Bob Graham. I'm the Executive Director of the Victor Chang Cardiac Research Institute. And I'm here today to talk to you about COVID-19 or COVID-virus, which is a very important disease, obviously, and one that's afflicting many, many people. And I'm sure people have lots and lots of questions about their risk and where we should go and how we should deal with this. If you have heart disease, are you at increased risk of contracting coronavirus? And the answer is you're not necessarily at increased risk of contracting it, but you're at increased risk of having more serious disease. We know that a lot of the problems are not just respiratory, that is not just affecting your breathing, but when you have very severe coronavirus problems, as you can have with any form of flu, then it can affect your heart directly. And people who are dying from coronavirus often are dying of heart problems rather than respiratory problems. It causes an acute myocarditis, an acute inflammation of the heart, and it causes acute injury to the heart muscle. So the heart doesn't function as well. What advice would I have for people who currently have a heart condition? I would advise them to take every precaution they can to see if they can minimize the chances of contracting the virus. And that is to stay away from crowds, to try and keep a distance of at least 6 to 10 feet from other people, to wash their hands regularly, it may sound unpleasant, but to put the toilet seat down before they flush it so you don't get aerosol spread, because it can be spread in feces, and to try and minimize their contact with other people. And the reality is that probably 60 to 70% of people are going to contract coronavirus. In most of those, in 80% of them, it's going to be a mild disorder. But if you have underlying heart disease, you're at increased risk of running into problems. So you want to try and be in that group of people who don't get it. And the best thing to do is to be as cautious as you can to reduce your chances of getting the virus. Look, anyone who's got an underlying heart condition, especially a serious one like is probably at increased risk if they were to get the virus. Now, the good news is that for some reason that we don't really understand yet, children seem to have relatively mild disease when they get the virus. There are lots of, it'll take time to get a vaccine. It's going to take 12 to 18 months at least to get a vaccine. And in the meantime, there are lots of potential other avenues we could look at to see if we can help in mitigating the severity of the virus disease. And that's going to take research, and it's going to take cooperation, and it's going to take ethics committees to be a little more lenient in what they require to allow these studies to go on in compassionate use. Now, that's a personal thing that we're grappling with, but these are serious times, and we need to sometimes look at serious ways of trying to reduce the risk to our population. Look, I think you need to consult your own doctor and your cardiologist, but the overall advice is yes, you should. And the reason for that is that because they've got an underlying heart condition, even the common flu can cause problems in people with heart disease. And also it will prevent your confusion if you get symptoms and you already have had the vaccination. It's more likely not to be the common flu, but to be coronavirus. So it's very wise to get it. And then the other question I frequently get is, should you be vaccinated early or late? And if you vaccinate early, you're not protected for the whole winter. On the other hand, given the situation at the moment, I think most people are going to would opt for going early, so that you at least are covered during this period when there's lots of virus around. An article I read only yesterday, really shows, I think, that we've underestimated the extent of this disorder. It's not a problem for the individual person, because as I said, 80% of people will do all right. But on a population basis, it's an enormous problem. It's like having the regular flu that we have every year, except it's 30 to 50 to maybe 100 times more lethal. So the death rate, from what we can gather, is somewhere between 1 and 2%. The death rate for the common flu is about 0.1%. So you're just looking at the flu, but it's a more deadly flu. So, and it also spreads before you have symptoms, it's very hard to contain it. And the only way to do that effectively is isolation, which is what we're all trying to do, and to try and reduce interactions with people who may carry it. And therefore, we need to not be in big crowds. I mean, it doesn't make sense to be, as the Prime Minister suggests, to be going to football games with 60,000 people. That doesn't make sense at the moment. I mean, one of the most telling things I heard of recently is that in Italy, they are so inundated with cases that anyone over 60 who's got a comorbidity is allowed to die because they don't have the facilities to look after them. If we get into that situation, you know, obviously, well, hopefully we won't, that's just tragic. I mean, it's just terrible for doctors to have to, and nurses to have to make that decision about who lives and who dies because they don't have the equipment and the wherewithal to treat them. So this is a serious situation, and I don't want people to panic, but I think people need to be cognizant of the risks and to try and reduce them. It is, and I think that we're going to be put our head in the sand. We're going to suffer with that. We need to be aggressively proactive about this. We are just starting a study to see if we can dampen down the excessive immune response that occurs when you get the virus. And that's what kills people. They get acute respiratory distress syndrome and they get this acute cardiac injury. And there's a small study just published in 7 patients suggesting that a certain type of cell can dampen down the immune response. And the nice thing is it doesn't have the receptors, those proteins on the surface of the cell that allow the virus to get in and kill the cell, those cells. So we can use those cells to both dampen down the immune response, and they are themselves immune to the virus. And so they seem to be doing really good things. So we are looking into potentially starting a trial. So that's very much in progress, and we're not there yet, but we hope to start that pretty soon. Look, I think that's an excellent question. Does it heighten the importance of medical research? I think nothing else has heightened the awareness of medical research and its importance than this COVID virus pandemic that we have at the moment. And I think everyone can see how vulnerable the population is. If we don't have medical research to help us, we're going to be in big problems, and you'll have what happened in the 1819 Spanish flu pandemic, when more people died than in the First World War. It's been estimated about 50 million people worldwide died. Now, to put that into perspective in context, don't forget now we have much better ways of treating viral diseases. We have ways of supporting people while they're very sick. So I don't think anything like that hopefully will ever happen again. But it shows you the power of these viruses, which can be really deadly and can only be addressed by having good medical research. What I'd like to say, I mean, I've given you lots of information here, which may come across as being frightening. But look, rest assured that the Australian government has been very proactive so far. A number of cases that we have here is minuscule. And we have really advanced medical treatment throughout Australia, which we can be very proud of. And we also have outstanding research. So I think one should be positive about this. And also don't forget, as I said, on the individual level, it's really not an issue because 80% of us are going to have a mild or asymptomatic disorder. It's for that smaller group of patients who are going to get severe problems that we really have to worry about. And if it spreads in the community and you get a lot of virus, then of course you're going to have a lot of people who are going to have serious problems. But rest assured that Australia is better off by, in many ways, than say the United States, which is also a developed country. And we have very good medical services here, and our government, both locally and also the federal government, have been very proactive about this. Yes, yeah, so let me just finish by saying that, look, as the executive director of the Victor Chang Cardiac Research Institute, We're obviously very concerned about all of people out there, and we're thinking of you at this time, and we're working as hard as we can to try and help.